afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the International Cultural Center. I'm Tibor Nagy, Vice Provost for International Affairs. I have the honor and pleasure to introduce this most august panel for this discussion. And we will make sure the program goes a full hour. We plan to give you guys 20 minutes for the discussion portion of it. Ambassador John Byerly will be the moderator. And after their discussion, I'll come up here and I'll call on audience members to make their points, and we'll get one of the microphones and pass them around. Please turn your phones on, because we love to hear the ring. With that, I really want to thank most sincerely Center for Global Understanding for making it possible to have this program for 3 years in a row, and then additional funding from the CH Foundation. And I wanted to ask the president of Center for Global Understanding to make his points not lasting longer than 30 seconds. Joe?
Ambassador Nagy told me 30 seconds, and then he said, no, you can stay an hour.
I've got a book, buddy.
Okay. Honestly and truly, here's what I want to say to you. The Center for Global Understanding thinks this is one of the best programs that we have ever been involved with. We want to keep it. This is our second year of doing it. Keep your eyes out for next year, the third year, and then we want to continue renewing it. So feel free to give us any comments. If you want to write it down on a piece of paper and hand it to me afterwards, we'd love it. But I hope you enjoy what the ambassadors have to say. Thank you for being here.
Please, a warm West Texas welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I want to get us started right away because we do want to have as much time as possible to hear from you. I think over the last 50 years, if we look at new administrations coming into power in Washington, they almost always face a list of daunting challenges. But when you look at what's confronting the Trump administration, I think it seems unusually, maybe even unfairly acute. Take a look. Can you hear me okay? Take a look at Europe, where some of our oldest and most important allies are feeling shaken by the Brexit vote and by the rise of these populist nationalist parties that are calling into question the very utility of the European Union and NATO. Take a look at Asia, where tensions in the China Sea and the possibility of conflict are rising, just at a time when the North Korean leadership is rapidly escalating its already bizarre and somewhat reckless behavior into the realm of the truly threatening. In the Middle East and Southwest Asia, we've been at war now for 16 years, and the military actions that we've been engaged in seem to have done little to stem the security threat that's still posed to us by violent radical Islamic terrorism and its most recent incarnation, the Islamic State. And then there's Russia, where the Kremlin's aggressive efforts to command respect, to recapture some of the ground that it feels it lost over the last 25 years, have now reached beyond Crimea and other parts of Ukraine to new fronts, the electoral battlegrounds of Europe and the United States. So this is what a new Trump administration is confronting, and by itself, this would be more than a handful. But the Trump administration faces these challenges and more at a time when many of the key institutions, the principles, the values that have guided us and our foreign policy for the past 70 years are being questioned as they've never been questioned before. Some critics, including President Trump himself, have argued that the costs of maintaining these institutions, of promoting these values, outweigh the benefits that the United States derives from them. Others claim that the very foundations of the post-World War II order are already eroding in a global power transition shift involving the rise of Asia, of China, and India. And still others make the case that the traditional order is under threat by a diffusion of power, pointing to the rise of non-state actors around the world. It's something akin to sailing into very troubled and dangerous waters just at the time that your navigation system seems to be breaking down. In this sea of troubles, keeping ourselves afloat, not to mention making sure that we're navigating forward in a kind of coherent way, is without a doubt a national security priority for us of the highest order. But any proposed courses of action, any solutions that might be bruited about, for any of those to be effective, we need to have support, understanding, and discussion among the American people, and that's why we're so happy to see so many of you here tonight. That's why the American Academy of Diplomacy is here. We want to engage in that discussion, hear from you, and together maybe begin to find some solutions to these questions. To structure our time most efficiently, I want to focus briefly on three or maybe four key regions of the world, examine the effects of the crisis, the conflicts that I've described, against the backdrop of this broader question of existential institutions. Then we look forward to hearing your own thoughts. To start us off, I'd like to turn to my friend and colleague, Ambassador Kurt Volker, who served as U.S. Ambassador to NATO under President George W. Bush, and probably knows more about Europe and the European continent than most of us in this audience. He joins us just having arrived from Brussels, in fact. Kurt, start us out.
Indeed. Thank you, John, and thank you all for coming out this evening. It is a real honor for me to be here and to engage with all of you. As you'll hear, I'm very passionate about these issues, and I'm glad that you are, too, as you show by coming here, and I hope we have a great discussion. I want to set out two things. One of them is why I believe the United States needs to be very actively engaged in foreign policy in the world. And secondly, why our alliance with Europe is critically important and something that is at risk right now. The first comes back to who we are as a country, as a people. Our values are what make us who we are. We are about freedom, democracy, market economy, the rule of law, justice for all. That's what makes us who we are. And as a country, we are better off in the world when those values are respected by others as well. Those values are on the ascendance. When those values are under attack or under threat, then it ultimately comes and affects us as well. So we have an interest in how things are developing in the world, independent of the fact that it is what people around the world would want for themselves. And yes, we want that for them too. There's an altruistic motivation to want to see people be successful, but there's also a self-interested motivation to see that our country is going to be doing well in the world. The problem that we have now is, as John outlined in his opening remarks, we have a lot of problems in the world right now. We have an aggressive Russia. We have a very assertive China. We have terrorists that are killing people in our countries, in allied countries, in the Muslim world. We have massive migration movements right now that are changing societies, refugee flows. There are any number of issues that really threaten our well-being. I forgot to mention North Korea nukes and Iranian nukes and so on. The countries in the world that most share our values, that reflect them in their societies, and that will join with us in tackling challenges around the world as we need them, are our allies in Europe. It's not only them. Of course, we have Japan, we have South Korea, we have Australia, but a critical mass is in Europe, and there are allies through NATO. Europe is facing unprecedented challenges itself right now. And you just think about the list of what leaders there are facing. Mass migration, as I said, from the conflict in Syria, from the African subcontinent as economic migrants, also from Afghanistan. They have an unresolved debt crisis. Greece is still a liability on the Eurozone. It's still unresolved. They've had slow growth. They've had issues with job creation. They have the migrants who've come to Europe are often speaking a different language, different culture, different religion, not integrating in societies. That has caused a backlash in societies where people feel that their own identities are being challenged in those countries. This has given rise to populist movements and nationalist movements on both the left and the right that are challenging traditional governments that are there. People are feeling that their governing elites in many places, Western Europe, France, Germany, UK, are not in tune with what the publics are worried about. And they are pushing for change, much as we've had a change election here in this country. They're concerned about their institutions, the European Union, NATO, even the relationship with the United States, questioning if those things are really serving their interests. And Russia, as I mentioned, has both been aggressive in changing borders in Europe, in attacking two of its neighbors, threatening others that are NATO allies, buzzing U.S. Navy ships in the Baltic Sea, deploying missiles in violation of the INF Treaty, not following the Conventional Armed Forces in Europe Treaty. So there's a lot of security risks in Europe as well. And they're also working to exploit these internal divisions inside Europe to try to divide them further. No matter how you look at it, I think for the United States, for our well-being in the world, we need Europe to be a strong and vital partner. If it is facing all these challenges and frankly failing under these challenges, that's going to hurt the United States directly. So we have an interest in trying to help make sure that they are successful in seeing their way through this. I'm optimistic about it. I don't see any reason why we can't. I also want to be clear that I don't see us having undue responsibility. It's not our job to be the world's policeman everywhere. It is not our job to take care of problems that Europe won't take care of itself. But we have an interest in the outcome, and so I think we need to be a very proactive catalyst to getting things to go where they need to go. And as I said, I do think I'm optimistic. If you just look at the single issue that the current U.S. administration highlights a lot, but is not the only one to do so, Obama did and Bush did as well, allied defense spending, getting it up to 2% of GDP. I think we are more on track today than we have been in the last 15 or 20 years that this has been something that I've been following. And I think that in the next couple years, we will probably get closer and closer to that mark. Partly, that's the pressure that's coming from Washington, but it's also partly the pressure that's coming from Moscow and their need to respond to that. So I am optimistic overall, but we do have a stake in this outcome. And as if we want to deal with the other issues, Russia, what to do about it, Ukraine, what to do about it, ISIS, what to do about it, crises and conflict in the Middle East, China, Iran, North Korea, these refugee flows, we're going to have to be working closely with our European allies. So we need them to be with us, and we need them to be strong. Thank you.
Thank you, Kurt.
I'd like to introduce Ambassador Kathleen Stevens. Kathy is one of our true China hands in the State Department, now retired. She also served as our ambassador in South Korea. She'll take us on a tour d'horizon of Asia.
Well, I'm going to make it very brief because what I look forward to most in this wonderful day we've had today is another discussion with all of you. And again, thank you so much for your wonderful hospitality. I've been so impressed with everything I've seen here at Texas Tech and in Lubbock. I'm not a China expert, but I've been interested in China ever since I was in college, and I studied a little bit of Chinese in college. But, you know, when I was a young woman, we did not have diplomatic relations with China, and actually when I joined the Foreign Service, we did not yet have an official embassy. We only established diplomatic relations, I mean, for some of us a certain age, hard to imagine, but, you know, in 1979. And I mention that because I think one thing, much as when we look at Europe, we can look at the role the United States played in rebuilding and establishing institutions that have served us and have served the world so well since World War II. Similarly, not only post-World War II with the rebuilding of Japan, but over the last 30 years, the United States has played a very important role in the Pacific in creating the kind of security conditions and open markets that have allowed for not only the prosperity of Japan and our other allies, such as South Korea, Philippines, Australia, but also, most importantly, in many ways, China. You know, we've seen over the last several decades the rise of China, or as China likes to say, the re-rise of China to what they consider to be their rightful place in the region, their rightful place in the world. But it does lead to the question of, what is that place? And I'll get to that without an answer in a moment. So, but I think we approach the many problems which we've already kind of laid out here and listed when it comes to Asia from a sense that we can feel good, I think, about as a country and as a people, not only our government, our foreign policy, but our businesses, our people, about the way that we have opened our markets, opened our schools, and built trading relationships and people-to-people relationships that have been good for us and good for hundreds of millions of people in Asia. Asia matters. Seems kind of obvious, but again, without wanting to discount the continuing importance of engagement in Europe, of engagement on issues in the Middle East and elsewhere. The center of gravity in some ways in the world has moved towards the Pacific. If you just look at trade figures, I mean, statistics, there's what, statistics and lies, but anyway, any figures will show that our economies, whether you're here in Texas or on either side of this big continent, it's moved towards Asia. So we have a greater interest in the issue of peace, prosperity, and open markets. If you look at issues like that are really those kinds of issues that now transcend borders, right? Global health issues. You know, we can no longer sort of handle everything within borders. That's why the EU and NATO are so important. Within Asia, we don't have those kinds of relationships, but, you know, what happens in India doesn't stay in India, right? Whether it's an innovation or whether it's a new disease. Pollution in China doesn't stay in China. It affects the region and indeed the world. Issues like nuclear nonproliferation, again, no boundaries. So cooperation with our partners and our allies, certainly in Europe but also in Asia, have become more important than ever. And China and India, China now is the most populous country in the world, India soon to be the most populous, clearly not at the economic development level that China is, but very important as the world's largest democracy, are increasingly going to define our futures, wherever we are, but certainly here in the United States. So we need to pay attention. I think this is a moment of some uncertainty, a moment when there is a questioning of whether or not the institutions and the approaches that have served us so well for the last several decades are sufficient going forward. And how does that translate itself in Asia? Well, first of all, I mean, I think it means whether we're in the United States or in Asia, people are asking again, what really is the nature of China's rise? How do we view that? And how do we view the U.S.-China relationship? China's now is the second largest economy in the world. Before too long, will be the largest economy just by, you know, sheer GDP. And it has a leader in Xi Jinping, who probably later this year will be announced for a kind of a second five-year term. They don't have a democracy, but they have a party system where, with a peaceful transfer to new leaders. Xi Jinping is one of the strongest, most ambitious leaders, I would say, that China's had in some time. Where does China want to go with that? I think those things can be shaped. But I think we still have, whether it's the Obama administration or earlier ones or now the Trump administration, sometimes a little bit of difficulty thinking, what are the words that define our relationship? We cooperate on many issues. We compete on many issues. We're friends. At times, there are elements of animosity. Some people have coined the word frenemy. I think it's all still in the mix as to how that plays out. And where does it play out? Well, it plays out in places like the South China Sea, where China is growing its military very, very rapidly. This is certainly, in many ways, I think, a natural function of a rapidly growing economy. And it wants to play a larger regional role. The United States has been the unrivaled power, and particularly the maritime power, in the Pacific, in the Western Pacific, since World War II. How do we feel about that? How do other countries in Southeast Asia feel about that? Some of them are pretty worried, especially the maritime countries. But to what extent are their interests our interests? These are all challenges that President Trump and his administration will need to address. There's also the question of what trade looks like going forward and what our economic relationships look like going forward. We saw in our own country in our recent political campaign, and we see it continuing in political dialogue, a lot of debate about whether or not free trade agreements, the kinds of agreements that we reached with NAFTA, with Mexico and Canada, with the Republic of Korea, where I served as ambassador, and was our largest free trade agreement since NAFTA. When we were negotiating with the EU, which did not was not completed, and an agreement that we had with 12 countries in the Pacific called the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which President Trump has withdrawn from. He said that's not the approach we want. But it does leave the question, what is the approach? And if there's a vacuum there, who's going to fill it? Is China going to write the rules of trade? Are we going to be left out? These really are questions that I'm not suggesting. Well, I'll give you my ideas, but an answer for. And you know, should we be negotiating bilateral trade deals with countries one by one by one? And if so, under what conditions? So there's a lot of concern, I think, in this country, and I said also in the region, because we do have, whether we like it or not, it's kind of, you know, one of the rules of diplomacy is you have to deal with the world as it is, right? We have an intertwined world, and certainly economically. I was talking to some business people from here at lunch about their global supply chains. They all go through Asia in some way. And I think you find that in virtually whatever your business is, including education for that matter, we are all intertwined. And finally, two more points, I guess. The other two points I would mention is issues that need to be addressed and are being addressed to some extent by the new administration, the Trump administration, is reassurance to our allies. Our alliance relationships in Asia are a little bit different than Europe. We don't have a NATO-like body. What we do have is bilateral alliances. The important ones in Northeast Asia, of course, are with Japan and with South Korea. In Southeast Asia, we also work closely with a number of Southeast Asian countries and have formal alliance relationships with the Philippines and Thailand, as well as alliance relationship with Australia. In any event, people worry, one, about China, and two, they worry about North Korea. North Korea, in particular, it's accelerating effort to consolidate a nuclear weapons program along with the ballistic missiles to deliver a nuclear warhead, both short-term and longer-term, has gone forward with very worrying and, I would say, surprising speed over the last several years. And so far, we have not found the right recipe to stop that program. It's a big challenge. It's a big challenge for whoever is president of the United States. And it's something that will confront and does confront, and he's talked about this, President Trump, whether it's as an immediate crisis, and does that crisis come when a long-range, an ICBM missile test is lined up for launch, or does it come with a military engagement or some kind of provocation or attack somewhere in the seas off of the Korean Peninsula? Wherever it does, we'll need to respond. We'll need to respond, hopefully, with our allies and with support of the international community. But it's something that any president, I think, is going to have to look at and say, if, you know, a couple of years from now we look and say, we didn't stop North Korea before they got to that next step that we said was unacceptable, that next step of the long-range missile, the miniaturization of the nuclear warhead, then it's going to be, you know, politically as well as from a security point of view, a huge vulnerability.
Thank you, Kathy. Ambassador Ron Newman is the president of the American Academy of Diplomacy. He's had a long and distinguished career in diplomacy in the Middle East and South Asia.
I'm talking to you tonight about one piece of the Middle East, but one that is extremely important, and that is the struggle with violent Islamic radicalism and with the Islamic State. We have now been at war in one fashion or another with this problem for the last 16 years, although in some respects longer. We have active military operations ongoing, Iraq, Syria, Afghanistan, Libya, Yemen, Somalia. American troops are in all of them. Some of you may have served there. Some of your children or your friends may serve there. This is a really complicated problem. And unfortunately, we've been discussing it in very simplistic terms. How many troops do we need? We need a more complicated discussion. because the problem is more complicated. I will, like many of my, like my colleagues, I'm not going to give you a solution tonight. Sorry about that. But I hope I will give you a little more way of thinking about the problem. So what I want to do is I want to define the problem that we're dealing with. I want to think, have you think about some of the parts that are necessary in any policy for it to be a success. And I want to reflect on what means are needed to make that policy work. Talking about the problem of the Islamic State, Al-Qaeda, there are variations, and it's a complex issue, but there are certain basics you can get down to. First of all, this is a complex theology that seeks to explain all the ills of society within a single framework. And it has a cure, the rebuilding of the caliphate and the adherence to not just Islamic law, but their view of Islamic law. It has a determination to destroy everything that stands in their path, starting primarily with Muslim states and Muslim populations who have not subscribed to their view, and then secondarily with the West. And this raises the issue that Muslim states and huge parts of the Muslim population are our natural allies in the struggle with the Islamic State. It does not make sense to cast off our allies as part of the struggle. The Islamic State and Al-Qaeda use terrorism and violence as a tactic, but note that terrorism is not the problem, it is the symptom. In other words, it's not the disease, it's the symptom by which you recognize it. But you don't treat any disease, or you hope not to treat a disease, only by treating a symptom. And that is something into which I think we've fallen. And another characteristic of the problem we're dealing with is its ability to find converts and to keep regenerating. So, if you look just at these points I've brought out, the nature of its threat, its ability to regenerate, where we find allies, you come to certain, a few, but certain conclusions. One is that we need clear policies. That's not just how many troops do we have to send someplace, it's what are we sending them for? How do you define the policy goal in the service of which you're building a strategy? We haven't been talking about that very much. We go to strategies right away as though we have a goal. Then there are a few key points that need to be part of the policy that we need to define. First, while military force is an absolutely essential part of the policy, it's not the solution by itself, because of the ability to regenerate in these movements. So that if you deal only with military force, you don't get to a solution. You just keep mowing the grass, and the grass keeps growing. Second, this is going to be a long-term proposition, no matter how much we might wish that it's not, because we have enemies who are prepared to stay at war for a long time. And they think they're at war with us. I don't know of any war where one side could unilaterally decide it no longer wished to be part of a war. It just doesn't work that way. Third, state stabilization has to be part of the goal, because there has to be something that comes after in order not to keep having the same problem. So how one stabilizes states so that they can control the radicalization that bursts out of them is a key, must be a key part of a policy. And from this comes my fourth point, which is that politics is going to be and must be part of each solution. It cannot be, we can't impose stability on foreign areas and then walk away. We have to build it. with foreigners, and that's a big, big process. So this definition of shaping of policy is going to be different for different areas. It's not going to look the same in a Yemen or in a Syria or in an Iraq. But because each situation is political, we need to stop this business of having separate political and military strategies. They need to work together. Often the military element is one of the greatest, heaviest tools we have lifting the political solution and making it work. But they need to work together so that as we confront the Islamic State in Iraq, for instance, we know that stabilization is going to be not just capturing Mosul and killing people, although that's going to be part of it, but it's also whether the communities can live together and whether they can work together, whether Mosul can be governed in some way that doesn't just trigger another crisis after the battle. How we hold back or use our military force can put pressure on the political leaders to work together. These are always going to be really hard issues because if you just help militarily, then you give them a free ride to give way to whatever their hardest political pressures are, which may have nothing to do with stability. If you hold back too much, you may allow the enemy to have battlefield gains. So you need to integrate the two pieces together. And that means that we need to see that force is a part of our political toolkit, but they have to work together. By the way, this discussion of politics means that the currently proposed cuts in the State Department budget are not sound. This is not a security budget. It is a budget that does not understand security. And I'm happy to go into that. In each case, if you're talking about stabilizing states, and this is much too big a job for the United States alone, unquestionably, we need to understand who our allies might be. We need to think about what the interests of the different parties are. That's what diplomats do for a living. We spend a lot of time listening to strange people to find out what it is they want, not to do things their way, but to figure out how you can get them to do things our way, where you have to make compromises, where you might get them to make compromises, how you might get different foreign parties to compromise with each other in order to build a coalition. That was one of the huge successes of the first Bush administration in the first Iraq war, is to figure out what the political issues were that we had to solve in order to bring together this incredible coalition that drove Saddam Hussein out of Iraq. That's part of what diplomats do, and that's why we need to keep them in business. Now, none of this will be easy. None of it will be fast. We are facing enemies that want to destabilize a good part of the world and that want to bring terror here to the homeland. We don't have a choice about continuing to confront this problem. I think we do have a choice about how we think about policy, how we explain it to the American people, and how we build policies that make sense. And I hope that this kind of discussion with you all can be a small piece of that. Thank you.
Thank you, Ron. A very brief word or two about Russia, and then we'll open it up for questions. President Trump is now the fourth president in a row to take power, promising that he would forge a new and different, more productive and positive relationship with Russia. Presidents Clinton, Bush, and Obama all arrived in power saying the same thing, and they all left office disappointed in that aim. What is it that President Trump needs to do or understand in order to achieve the goal of having what I think we would all agree is a good thing, a relationship where Russia works with us instead of against us? It requires understanding that the Russia today is very different than the Russia that emerged after the Soviet Union fell apart. That Russia was very happy, even eager, to take Western advice, to take Western assistance, and essentially to be a junior partner to the United States in Europe. President Putin has made clear that those days are over for Russia, that Russia is going to insist on its place at the head table internationally. This makes dealing with Russia very different because we got used to dealing with a Russia which was a bit more congenial to our interests, and we need to recalibrate. But we still have an existential stake in having a productive relationship with Russia, if only because Russia has a nuclear arsenal to rival the size of ours, and it still regards the United States as something of an adversary. So that gives us an existential stake, a really self-survival stake in trying to craft something with Russia that is less, that is more cooperative and less obstructive. We're also in a position, because of who we are, to help Russia's neighbors deal with the threats and the challenges that they feel from Russia. And Kurt talked about that. I don't need to go into that in detail. And of course, we can cover this in the Q&A. The problem I think that President Trump is going to face in this is domestic. Unlike almost every other foreign policy ambition that he has enunciated, he has almost no support on Capitol Hill, and certainly not among the media, whether you're talking about Fox News or MSNBC, that somehow he can be a better friend to Mr. Putin. This will make the job extremely difficult, but it makes it no less vital to our interests that we find a way to work with Russia on the issues that we have common stakes and common interests, and not let those get infected by the areas in which we're going to probably disagree for a long time. With that as a final word from me, I'll ask Tibor to come up and help with recognizing you. We look forward to hearing your questions. And thanks for staying with us through this run around the globe that we
so
just gave you.
Phenomenal points, ladies and gentlemen. And we're not just looking for questions here. We're also looking for, you know, your response to some of the points that they made.
Hi, I'm Dave Lewis from the Political Science Department. We seem to have this perpetual neo-Wilsonian view of creating the world in our own image or recreating the world in our own image. And I want to speak specifically to South Asia and perhaps the Middle East, where it seems like planting the seeds of democracy was a noble goal, but it hadn't really produced much in that region. Do you think it was a good idea, poorly executed, or just a bad idea?
I guess that's me. A little bit of both. I'd separate out countries a bit. In Iraq, I think we absolutely had no idea what we were doing when we went in. We had a whole series of ideas about what would happen, all of which turned out to be wrong. I spent 16 months in Iraq, by the way, before my reward was to go to Afghanistan. We had very grandiose, at a certain leadership level, we had very grandiose visions about what we were going to do and very little understanding. And we were also dealing with an extraordinarily complex society where we had essentially ripped off or unfrozen 70 years of, not 70, but years of conflict that had been frozen under Saddam Hussein, so that in many ways Iraq was recomposing its own political society, and it made it very difficult to even know who was who, because they were settling scores among themselves. Afghanistan's a very different picture. It's also very difficult, but I would say there you have a measure of support and progress. For one thing, having some movement toward democracy is almost the only way to get out of the power competition with the gun. So where are we? We've had the last election, you had something like 70% of the electorate voted despite threats to kill them for going to the polls. That's a pretty strong domestic endorsement of wanting this. Then you had massive fraud, not good. Then you had finally a political resolution, and power changed peacefully, virtually for the first time in Afghan history. We still have enormous problems to get over, and we could still break the system by this effort to create a democracy. And yet it is something the Afghans, the people, I think, overwhelmingly want, a peaceful means to alternate and control power in Afghanistan. And we don't have an alternative. We'll probably have some very messy Afghan version. I think we want to be very, very careful about trying. I'd just as soon not do another war. And if we did, I'd like to have the efficient, creative, and charismatic leader on our side. But at the same time, where there is room to move, I think it is still worth moving on it, but recognize that democracy development is a generational change. It's not something you can do quickly. If you try to do it quickly, then the answer to your question would be unquestionably that it's going to be a mistake.
I'd like to just add a couple thoughts to that. One, the reason I think we keep coming back to what you describe as a Wilsonian view of changing the world is because if we stand still and do nothing, the world goes after us. Because people around the world share the same attachment to the core values that we do. It's just that small groups of people like to dominate everybody else. And they do it for power, they do it for money, they do it for geography, they do it for religion, they do it for whatever reason that might be. And they go after each other, and oftentimes they go after us because of who we are and because of our values. And so it is in our own interest to try to see that those values do spread a bit. Now, I agree completely with Ambassador Newman here that this is not something that you can just go out and flip a switch and it happens. It's got to be something that we approach with persistence and with realism. And realism, in particular, meaning that taking the Middle East in your area, for example, the most powerful groups are the dictators, the militaries, and the Islamist extremists. So even though a majority of people might like to live in a different type of country, very hard for them to bring that about. And yet even there are good examples. And I'd say Tunisia is a very exciting example right now where there's enough there that people are actually governing themselves with a measure of respect for each other in society, a measure of limits of government, change within society. And I think that is a reason for optimism. It's just going to take a very, very long time.
Ambassador Stevens, you talked about, correctly, I believe, the acceleration of North Korea's effort toward nuclear delivery systems. It seems to be going faster than anyone expected it could. It seems to me that in terms of a diplomatic solution, our only chance is leveraging China to somehow get this mad dog in North Korea under control before we finally get to that point of preemptive self-defense in a military sense, which no one, I think, wants. And can you give me a warmer, fuzzier feeling that something's going on in the diplomatic area there?
Well, I'm not sure I can be warm and fuzzy about anything having to do with North Korea, but I think it was important that Secretary of State Tillerson went to the region, Tokyo, Seoul, and Beijing. The order's important. He saw our two allies and then went to Beijing. And that a major topic, not the only topic, a major topic of the conversation was North Korea and the challenges it posed. China agrees with us and that North Korea should not have nuclear weapons. China has worked with us in the Security Council to pass resolutions condemning its missile tests, its nuclear tests, to impose sanctions, and so on. I think where our interests diverge a little bit is that China is more fearful of the alternative if the alternative means instability in North Korea, leading to North Korean refugees fleeing into China, a collapse of the regime, reunification under a Seoul-dominated government with U.S. troops that might be moving further north towards the Yalu, you know, further and further. So I think, this is my own opinion, that one thing we need to do with China, and this is start of this is the part of the new administration building a relationship with China of candor and frankness, which is very challenging with the Chinese, to talk about what change in North Korea might look like and how we think about some of the contingencies. It's easier for us. It's hard enough to do with our allies, right? But we try to do that. But we need to do it with China too, because China plays a big role. And the other part of it is more on the pressure side on China, and that is to say to China that if there are pressure points that are not there, for example, Chinese companies or banks that continue to deal with North Korea and provide it the economic support it needs to continue its program, that we will go after those too. So I think it's going to be, again, a process that's going to play out over a period of time, but we also know that time is not on our side. And I think if we probably made a number of mistakes, and I'm talking about several successive administrations, but one is thinking that we had more time than we did. And I do think that one of the reasons for the acceleration of the program is Kim III, the grandson now, the founding leader of North Korea, Kim Jong-un, he's now been in power almost 6 years. And my own read is when he took power, he decided this was the best way to try to protect his regime. And finally, the other part of it is, you know, do we say to this regime, give up your nuclear weapons? This has been our approach, and we will provide, you know, survival for your regime. That is something that I think will be continue to be tried, but my expectations that will work is probably as low as it's ever been.
Thank you very much. How about on that side? Okay, right there.
Very thankful for you to come and visit Texas on this one. I'm listening to the discussion, and I'm reminded of a phrase which is, a mind convinced against its will remains a mind unchanged still. Force doesn't seem to work. How is diplomacy going to change that balance to get some progress on these issues?
Oh, well. I think that's Jonathan Swift, isn't it? In any event, diplomacy is not just sort of toothless gumming and trying to persuade people to do things that they don't want to do. It is a process of identifying interests, identifying common points, bringing those points together. Doesn't always work. For instance, take an historical example. I mentioned the coalition that drove Saddam Hussein out of Iraq. One of the key points that emerged as James Baker, then Secretary of State, was making his rounds of the Arabs was their focus on the Middle East peace process. What came out of that was more complicated than I'm making out, but his commitment that we would restart the peace process after the war, which we did, didn't succeed, but we did. That understanding of their interests brought Egypt, Syria forces into the war, overwhelming Arab support for foreign forces in the war. That didn't happen by itself, and it didn't happen just because we went out and asked people to do it. It was part of identifying common interests. And that's diplomacy's role. It does not always work. It's not always a panacea. But it is essential. Totally different kind of role. For instance, you can have crises that are not military political. We didn't talk about them, but for instance, Ebola, sudden threat of a pandemic, and it was our embassies on the ground that did not withdraw, that stayed and became the base for a multi-agency deployment that contained the disease. So
diplomacy works a whole variety of fields, but it's a process of identifying interests. Right now, Syria, you've got Turkey, ourselves, Europeans, others all fighting that have a lot of interest together, not counting the Russians and the Iranians. We need to identify how we can bring that coalition together in a longer-term way for future stability. Right now, we're only focusing on how we can sort of coax it together militarily, and it's not holding.
I'll just give you a quick example regarding Ukraine and sanctions against Russia. Russia is now in the third year of economic sanctions tied to what it's doing in southeast Ukraine, both from the United States and Europe. President Putin, after 2 years of denying that these sanctions had any effect, he sort of dismissed them, now admits that they are having an effect on the Russian economy, which is not coincidentally in its third year of stagnation. Falling oil prices play a part in this, there's no question, but both the economic sanctions and the diplomatic isolation of Putin, he's not welcome in Western Europe, he's not welcome here in the United States, have reached a point where it's time to sit down with Mr. Putin, and this is where the diplomats come in, and say, if you want the sanctions lifted, here is what we need to see in southeast Ukraine. This is part of a process. Obviously, it's complicated because the Ukrainians also need to do some things. But sanctions in and of themselves are only a tool to get to the point where the person being sanctioned wants them off and is willing to change his behavior. I hope we can reach a point in the next year where we can sit down and test that proposition with Mr. Putin. You need diplomats to do that.
I saw that.
In reference to Russia, I was thinking back to the invasion of Georgia, the annexation of Crimea, and the conflict in the Ukraine. And I wondered your thoughts about the implications and the outcomes of drawing lines in the sand, perhaps not in that direction, but in a different direction, that then we let that line go past. And I'm talking about the use of chemical weapons in Syria. And so on the one hand, you have force, which the gentleman before said doesn't work. And I would probably argue that Japan is an ally. And as messy and horrific and disgusting as it was, that force seemed to have an effect that was long-term that still stands, whether it does, you know, in perpetuity, who knows. But lines in the sand implying force, that there's something that's going to happen that will make us act. Do you think that some of the instability in the actors who weren't implicitly involved in that line is due to the fact that we let that line slide?
You're talking about the Obama administration and the famous red line on the use of chemical weapons, which was then crossed. Yeah. Did that have an effect? Did that embolden people like Putin? Yes, I think it did.
And so, how do you resolve that without being overly aggressive on the other side?
We resolve it by, you don't really resolve it, you manage the problem. I think our problem as Americans sometimes is we think all issues are problems that we need to resolve. And I said this earlier in the day to a different audience. We look at Russia in that way. We need to solve the problem of Russia. Russia's a set of circumstances that are going to pose problems for us, and we need to manage those circumstances for a long time. And when it comes to the use of force, which is the gravest issue that any president has to confront, it has to be done judiciously. And words need to mean what they say. And you simply cannot encourage people by giving them the impression that you don't mean what you say.
I just want to add to that and maybe go a little bit more in your direction. I think you're absolutely right here that this was it was nearly catastrophic in terms of Syria, that by having said that there's a red line and then not acting, That gave extraordinary confidence to the Assad regime, gave confidence to Russia to intervene into Syria. It prolonged and expanded the conflict, and I think it's really been a catastrophe as a result. I also think it had the same effects on Russia, where it not only saw what did not happen in Syria, it also saw that with its own interventions, there was no real effort to stop that or push it back, and so they'd try the next thing, and they'd try the next thing. No one thought they would start up an uprising in Crimea. They did. No one thought they would then annex Crimea. They did. Still nothing. No one thought they would start it up again in eastern Ukraine. They did. And so I think the answer to your question, as I would see it, is you need to have a very clear sense of what it is you care about and what you don't. You need to communicate that clearly and then stand by it. You have to be judicious. We can't do everything. And if we don't mean a red line in Syria, we shouldn't say it. But if we do say it, it has to be because we mean it, and we have to follow through. And that
the one part of that I just want to add, by the way, I am not opposed to using military force. There are certain things where it does resolve things. But what I want to say is, if you're going to have a red line, you need to do everything Kurt said. You also need to think about what is it you're going to do when the line is crossed. Once the line's crossed, it's a bit late to try to figure out that decision. You need to have made that mind. You need to have made your mind up, not just that you mean it, but that you actually have some notion about what it is you mean.
No, well, thank you for that question. I mean, first of all, it's somewhat related, but also related to the earlier point. When it comes to Japan and post-war Japan, I think that's an excellent example, and I would add South Korea to this as well. After devastating wars, we didn't think the military had done the job and we were done. We made a real commitment there and a real investment, not only of treasure, but of people, and not only diplomats, but business people and aid workers and so on. And it's paid off. In a big way for us and for those countries. With respect to, you said, kind of soft power budgets, actually, I was just in this week's Economist magazine, there's a long article about China's soft power budget, or they call it, and I think it was in the billions, $10-15 billion a year, and it was noting that the U.S., what they were calling the soft power budget, was actually a little part, I think it's being cut in the proposed budget of the State Department budget for things like cultural exchanges, American studies programs. It's about, I think it was about $600 million. But that includes things like the Fulbright Scholars, all these exchange programs, so on and so forth. So, yeah, I think we should do more. I think it's a fantastic investment. It makes use of our best resource, which is our people and our communities, for a very, very small, almost just kind of a priming the pump kind of investment from the U.S. government. And I think we cut that at our peril.
We did invest a lot more money in American studies during the Cold War and after. And I think in a way we may be reaping the dividends from that, because one of the greatest attributes of American soft power right now is universities like Texas Tech, which attract thousands of foreign students, people who want to come to our country and study. I used to confront this a lot as ambassador when I would have to argue with Russians who say, everybody in our country hates America and you're doing the wrong thing. And I'd say, if that's so, why are the lines outside the visa office at the embassy so long every day? Why are people lining up to get their kids into American universities if America is such a bad place? So maybe one of the reasons that they're not teaching American studies in Tokyo anymore is a lot of Japanese students are studying in America.
Thank you for being here. My name is Jorge Ramirez. I'm a professor of law in the area of international law. And I have a question that kind of takes off on this question of budgets. President Trump has his current proposed budget seeks to cut the State Department and USAID agency and other agencies by one-third. Based on your experiences, do you really think there's that much waste in the department? Do you think there are higher priorities? And if not, what impact will these cuts have on American diplomacy across the world?
Mr. President.
Yeah. That's a reference to my day job at the American Academy, where we have taken a position violently against the, well, as violent as you could expect from diplomats. But first of all, this isn't going to really help. You just can't get enough out of the State Department budget. You can do enormous harm, because what you have is the soft power we were talking about. I don't really like that term, but the intelligent power, education, bringing people here. The use of aid with refugees, for instance, is a matter of humanitarian aid, but it's also a matter of dealing with people where you have the seeds of much more radicalism. You don't want to just turn your back on that and walk away. That is a way of allowing things to grow until they can really reach out and bite us. Also, I have heard people say in this administration, well, others will need to do more. I agree they need to do more, but I will tell you that they don't do it. At least they won't do it in the places that we would like them to do it if we're not leading and part of that. I had this experience at one point in the second Bush administration when they cut the budget for Afghanistan because we were doing everything in Iraq. And the argument was, we'll get the others to do more. And I remember having the unpleasant but slight pleasure of telling Secretary Rice a year later that she had not succeeded, nobody else had, in finding one real dollar from any foreign country to fill any of the things we had proposed doing that we were not doing. It just doesn't work. We send UN peacekeeping forces. That's another area being cut in the state budget. We have a veto on the Security Council. Forces don't go places that we don't think they should go. In many cases, they go to places that we don't want to put our own troops. And they're part of stabilizing areas that could be dangerous to us. And they cost about one-eighth of what it costs to deploy U.S. troops. So you just multiply one place after another where it's not a matter of, you know, why are you doing that abroad because we have needs at home? It's that you're safeguarding your own security in a whole variety of ways. And that's why I say that this budget is not really a security budget. It's a budget that shows a lack of understanding of the full breadth of where our security lies. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have one more question. It's a really dying
My question is to Ambassador Stevens, and it's that the United States has close allyships in Asia with countries such as India and Japan, and our support in large measure helps protect the pacifist policies in those countries. Will engagement with China, a country with hostilities across the Pacific, make these countries feel abandoned and make Asia more precarious in the long run?
Well, first of all, we have rather different relationship with Japan and India. Yeah. With Japan, indeed, we do have a security alliance a relationship. You know, Japan's constitution, essentially imposed by the United States, in that constitution, they forswore having a regular military, but they've moved a long way since then. And in fact, they have quite, if you look at military budget figures, I'm sure you could Google them somewhere, they actually spend quite a bit and are spending more under Prime Minister Abe because of the changing security nature in the region. So they are doing more, mostly in the region, and I think they'll continue. But they do have a strong, they're still a very strong pacifist voice within the Japanese public. There's also some nervousness, not so much on the part of China, but some other neighbors, including Korea, about the notion of a remilitarized Japan. I happen to think those fears are exaggerated, but that is an issue. But Japan is doing more, I think, to partner, and as President Trump discovered, I think, when he met with Mr. Abe, the Prime Minister, Japan spends a lot of money on the stationing of U.S. troops in Japan. They pick up most of those expenses. With respect to India, that's an interesting one, because India is obviously a very big country that also has a complicated relationship with China, is concerned to some extent about China's reach into what's traditionally been India's neighborhood in the Indian Ocean and the South and South Asia, and they are also interested in doing more with us on the military as well as the political side. I don't think that they're interested in having a formal alliance, but I do think that, particularly under the current Indian government, under Mr. Modi, and also because of the fact that there is such a large and burgeoning Indian diaspora here, which has kind of changed in some ways and deepened the nature of the relationship, that we will be doing more and more with India in the years forward, particularly if India's economy is able to get some traction and grow at rates that keep up with its young and burgeoning population.
Any parting words of wisdom from any of the members of the panel? Anybody?
Stay engaged. Thank you.
Please stay.